Welcome to the Hollywood Scholar, I'm Jed Morgan, and I really haven't talked about Witcher in quite a while now because there hasn't really been a whole lot of news, with no news about Witcher Season 3, the Netflix universe, or even the video games coming out in any sort of substantial way. Even news about how well the Next Gen Edition is doing has been relatively silent, and I do have to admit I was wrong about the Next Gen release. I was afraid when news said it would have some content changes and content additions that it would not be good, that it would change the actual story in a substantial way, especially considering the ESG video that was released by CD Projekt Red a few months ago and their ESG stance. I was afraid that that stance would affect the story and force them to change things, change important aspects of the game for diversity, inclusion, and political reasons. I have to fully admit, I was 100% wrong. The Next Gen Edition is great. No real issues with it. Some bugs initially, but that's to be expected from CD Projekt Red. All been ironed out now, and even the Netflix Quest, where you get the Netflix armor, is actually really well written. I quite enjoyed that content and addition, but it is a side plot that doesn't affect the overall story. So that is a content and addition I am 100% okay with. But when it comes to the Netflix universe, really hasn't been a whole lot. Ever since Blood Origin Disaster, Netflix has been very, very quiet about casting announcements, about plans for Season 3, about the change from Henry Cavill to Liam Hemsworth. Really hasn't been a whole lot going on from the Netflix, and rightfully so, because they're probably afraid of getting ratioed to hell and back because of how many people despised the latest addition into their Witcher universe. I hope this means that they cancel all the potential spinoffs that they have with their plan of 1 year Witcher season, 1 year spinoff, and so on and so forth, especially because the next spinoff is going to be a rat spinoff that supposedly is going to focus specifically on Ciri. We don't need another Ciri show. The main Witcher show has already been co-opted to be about more Ciri and Yennefer than Geralt himself. So we don't need a spinoff just to focus on Ciri even more, especially because all her interactions with the rats are included in the books, so they should be included at the end of Season 3 and in Season 4. It doesn't make any sense, so I hope that gets rightfully canceled, even though it's going to start filming very soon here, according to rumors. But we do have a little bit of news that I want to go over, because there's not a whole lot else going on news-wise today. So let's jump right into it. We have this article from Redanian Intelligence that is listing every cast member for The Witcher Season 3 we know so far. Some of these we've talked about before, some of them we haven't, but let's just jump into them right now. This first one is the one that surprised me the most, is we've got a casting for Milva. And for those of you who don't know, in Book 3, Baptism of Fire, Geralt starts traveling around with a group of people trying to fight through the Nilfgaardian war zone and find Ciri, who teleported to the southern Nilfgaardian desert. The problem with this is she shouldn't be in the show yet. She should be in Season 4, because she doesn't arrive until after Geralt is injured at the Battle of Thanet, which is the climax of Time of Contempt, which is the book that Season 3 is adapting. So she should not be in Season 3 whatsoever. So they're already changing the story and that aspect. And of course, it's another race swap, but my bigger problem is she's from Shang-Chi, and that was an awful movie with a lot of really, really bad performances, even from good actors. But this actress was not very impressive in the movie whatsoever, so Milva's probably not going to be that good whatsoever. And Milva is an incredibly important character. She's fighting with Geralt against her better judgment. She knows he's in love with Yennefer, but she's still in love with him anyway, and is willing to go to the ends of the earth with him because of her feelings for her. She's a tortured character, and she has a great story and a tragic end. This doesn't seem like the right choice for that, and introducing her too early can really affect that in a negative way. Some of these are Robbie Amell, he's been good in other performances I've seen of him. His brother's better, but this is an original character, so I have nothing to say about it, because original character, not much I can say. There are plenty of characters in the Witcher universe, though, so they shouldn't be really creating that many new characters, but whatever. Then we got Lorna Brown playing the Queen of the Broculon Dryads, and we already saw this character in Season 1 when Ciri went to Broculon Forest, but apparently they had to recast the character. Still the same character. It's already race swapped, so whatever, that's old news at this point. We've got a casting for Prince Radovid. This guy is way too old. Radovid should be a teenager at this point, not in his 30s, because yeah, he's a very, very young man, and it's not until the events of the Witcher video games where he becomes an adult, becomes king, and really starts to show the madness that exemplifies his character. At this point, he's really nothing to be. He's barely a character in the Witcher books, and he's definitely a child. This actor is way too old. So again, they're changing the source material, and that has not gone very well for Netflix so far, changing the source material. And then we've already talked about this casting for Folka. It's whatever. Folka is the violent and bloodthirsty demon from history. She is the most violent person in The Witcher's history. Philippa is one of the few people who believe that it's a misnomer, that she's not actually as bad as history says she is. Regardless, she is responsible for the most bloody time in human history upon the continent, whether or not she intentionally brought about that violence or it was an accidental bringing about of that violence. She murdered her father, her stepmother, and her two half-brothers with her bare hands with gleeful joy. Whether or not that action was intended to create one of the bloodiest revolutions in history, she still did that herself. So it's really not a good sign when they race swap characters, because whenever they race swap, it's a thing that in modern day you can't show diverse people in such a negative, bad light. And they've race swapped her. So I imagine they're going to go with Philippa's interpretation that she's a victim, which is very much in line with the current regime at Hollywood and in line with a lot of the other changes that Netflix has made in their Witcher universe. And she's basically Witcher's Hitler. She's basically Witcher's Hitler. And they race swapped her. That's not something you want to know. This casting is fine. I didn't really enjoy this guy's performance in Valhalla. He wasn't great, but at least he has the look of Crokhan Krake, and he's roughly the right age. Great. I'm all right with that, Crokhan Krake. He shouldn't really be a big character yet. It's later on when we get more flashbacks about him that he becomes an important character. A lot of these, not really familiar with these characters. Queen Hedwig, this is the mother of Prince Radovid. She's from Doctor Who, so I like that. She's definitely barely in it, or should be, by according to source material. She's literally just stands in the background. But knowing Netflix and knowing how big of an actress this is, I'm sure they're going to change that from the source material as well. Not a whole lot of changes here. And then we have the race swapped and diversified weight-wise as well, Margarita. And Margarita is supposed to be the most beautiful of the sorceresses. And she should have been in Blood of Elves, but they cut her out for Blood of Elves. She was actually very important, but when you take out Yennefer's powers and Yennefer and Ciri's storyline from that book entirely, you cut out Margarita's side of the story in Blood of Elves as well. So she's not going to be in this very much, because at least according to the source material, I have to preface that because they're not even following the source material, so this might be totally different, but in the source material, she's only really in Time of Contempt at the end at the Battle of Thanet and the Summit at Thanet. And that's whatever. Kier Metz, another race swap. There's so many race swaps, and it's just getting tiring at this point. This is the recast of Ryan's because the original actor had to fall out. This guy just does not have the intimidation factor, it looks like, just from this image. I'm just judging off this image. Maybe he'll be great in the role. I don't really know, but Ryan's is supposed to be intimidating and then kind of pathetic later on after Yennefer burns his face and when it's revealed that he's working for someone like Tawny Owl. And we have a couple others, whatever, a lot of original characters, some that we don't really care about. The rats, we already knew about Missile's Racewatt, which is Ciri's lesbian lover. It's whatever. Some of these other castings for the rats, they're nothing unexpected, and then a lot of rumored ones. He's all right for Fabio. He's fine. He seems a little old, but they're aging everybody up at this point, so what's unexpected? And the rest of these are all rumored and side characters that we don't really know anything about, so it's not worth talking about them. So that's the cast we have announced for Witcher Season 3. Isn't that going to be so exciting? And to round out this video, I wanted to talk about a few Shield articles, of course, from Screen Rant specifically, and another one from another place, but it's just really, it's always fun to mock the Shields occasionally. But The Witcher continues a bizarre Lord of the Rings dwarf debate, so this is just bringing up the debate from the Rings of Power days when it was Disa doesn't have a beard. Why doesn't have Disa have a beard, even though that's canonical? And the same thing with this character from Witcher Blood Origins. She doesn't have a beard either. And of course, they spend the whole article talking about how toxic fans are and why should they expect source material accuracy and all the normal stuff. But then they finish out for why they believe that Netflix and Amazon both decided not to include dwarven women with beards, even though they both mention that it is possible within the universe. Like the girlfriend of the dwarf in Witcher Blood Origin, she had a big fine silken beard and they mentioned it, but they don't actually show it. So this is their explanation for why both studios decided not to include it. The mere act of putting an actress in a false beard risks coming across as mocking, echoing the unfortunate history of bearded women as carnival sideshows to be stared at a curiosity. Both of these shows acknowledge female dwarves can have beards, but adapting that idea into live action is a feat neither franchise has attempted yet. So it's because bearded women were mocked in history. That's why they're changing the source material, according to Screen Rant. They're coming up with some really bonkers reasons to explain why they're not going with the source material, when the better reason is they don't like the source material, and that's been proven time and time again, especially with The Witcher, but definitely add Rings of Power considering the garbage that they wrote and the adaptation percentage at being like point naught. point not one, maybe, but this is their explanation for why no bearded women. I just had to call that out because that's really, really dumb. Moving on, I just wanted to briefly tell everyone that this character, who is a made-up character, the made-up boyfriend of Arien, King of the Wild Hunt, one of the most fearsome warriors in the known multiverse, which is only a couple of worlds, to be honest. He was known on set as Fancy Gay Jesus.
He's known as Fancy Gay Jesus.
I don't have much commentary on that besides to say, Fancy Gay Jesus, huh? Why? Why? You don't look like Jesus. My bigger thing is, where's the fancy and Jesus part? We know he's gay, but why is he fancy and Jesus? I don't get it. But moving on, Screen Rant also has a shill article about why Netflix's Witcher has a problem with incest coming up, and it's going to draw undue comparisons with Game of Thrones. So they go on praising both shows incessantly, but saying, hey, it needs to go away from Game of Thrones because of the incest thing that's coming up in the Witcher books. Is incest is brought up several times, and it's actually already been in the books and in the show already, but it's going to become much more prominent near the end of the show once she goes to Ayn El, Ciri goes to Ayn El, and once we get a little bit more interaction with Emperor Emir, there's going to be some more incest brought up. But their issue with it is it's too much like Game of Thrones, and their explanation of how to fix this is to stray further from the source material because it's too similar. Both shows have incest, so Witcher, who's already getting criticized for breaking the source material at every single possible opportunity, they need to go further away from the source material, anger fans even more, and that way fans will like it more because it's less like Game of Thrones. That is some mental gymnastics of the highest order, and I'm just quite impressed that they were managed to come up with something that asinine. That asinine, that is really quite special, even from a place like Screen Rant. The show's already getting dragged through the mud for Witcher Blood Origins, terrible adaptation and terrible writing. Why make things worse by making the source material null and void to a further degree by taking out the incest entirely, just to make it not sound like the Game of Thrones incest plotline? And the bigger thing that I want to point out is this is an unfair comparison when it comes to the books, because the original Game of Thrones book, which started off with incest, was released August 1st, 1996. And guess when the first short story of The Witcher that contained incest was published? Any ideas? How about a decade earlier? A decade earlier. So if anything, you could make an argument, even though it's not remotely true, that Game of Thrones ripped off The Witcher. So no, the source material should still be adhered to. That's already the biggest problem with Netflix. Not that I'm going to believe they're going to do it, and they're probably going to cut out incest. They're probably going to follow in Screen Rant's reasoning there. It's still asinine, though, because it far predates it. And by 1996, most of the series was done. The third book in the actual novel series, but the fifth book overall, including the short stories, was already out. They only had two main novels left to publish. And yes, those are the ones that contain the most incest, but enough the series was out at that point that you can't say that The Witcher ripped off Game of Thrones as incest when it comes to the books and the source material. And fans who know anything, do any research, or care will understand that fact and respect the show if it does keep to the source material. But the shills, that shill rant, and the access media sites pander to, they're not going to do any research. They only know what's in the moment. And so they're going to be like, they don't think I know he had incest, this has incest, it's a ripoff. And they're not smart enough to understand it. Of course, they're still going to love it incessantly because shills don't know how to say no to a product that's shoveled in their face by garbage studios. But real fans are going to be able to look at this in a reasonable light and understand, hey, source material came first, so great, stick to the source material. That is something that Netflix has proven time and time again that they're incapable of. So I have no doubt whatsoever that Screen Rant is predicting the future, that the Netflix Witcher show will probably steer clear of the incest because of the Game of Thrones connotations. And that just sucks because it opens up a lot of interesting possibilities with both the main villains of the books. Both main villains of the books have an interest in an incestuous relationship with Ciri, and that's a big part of their motivations. If you take out incest from The Witcher, you lose the motivations for the villains, and things stop making sense cohesively throughout the entire series. Because if the villains' motivations don't make sense, nothing they do makes sense, and that means the inciting incidents that these villains cause, none of them make sense. So the Wild Hunt's motivations don't make sense unless Oberon wants some incest baby with Ciri. The Nilfgaardian Empire, you could make some sort of argument that they just want power, but a lot of his motivations are centered around incest as well with Emperor Emir, and they're just asking for more changes. That's all that Shield Rant wants at this point, is to go down further the route that destroyed Witcher Blood Origin and is destroying this franchise summarily because they're not sticking to the source material. It's simple, but Shield Rant and Netflix seem incapable of understanding one of the most simple things about adapting from source material. Stick to the source material. Fans like it for a reason. It's considered good for a reason, and you're incapable of doing anything better, and you've proven that time and time again. Be better. Netflix, Screen Rant, Shields. But anyway, that's all I have for today. I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. Please like, share, and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video. Anon.
Hey, yo, are you feeling what I'm doing up in here? Oh, I know you are. Do you miss all the good, compelling stories that we used to get back in Hollywood that they ain't putting down no more? Oh, I know you missing it. So check out my book series, Odyssey of a Phoenix, a mythological epic about philosophy, morality, and modern-day mental illness issues, baby. Book one, Down in Flames. Book two, Apocalypse Then. These are currently on sale. What are you waiting for? Get your hands on them. And we got book three, Kill the Dark, is coming down the pipeline. Just wait for all the good stuff that's dropping. You ain't gonna be disappointed, fam.